praying about, meditating over. And I just ask right now that God would help me to bring this word to you. If you would please stand, I just would like to read one verse of what was read earlier in your hearing. And this is what we need if we want to have more love and more power and more of God in our life. Thank you for that song, Brother James. More. As a matter of fact, I can't preach when Jesus is not lit up. Sorry. I got to do that. Sorry. I just looked up there and said, uh-oh. Can't see the Lord. More power, more love, more power, more of you in my life. From the love chapter that was just read earlier in your hearing, verse 11 says this. When I was a child, I talked like a child, and I thought like a child, and I reasoned like a child. But when I became a man or a woman, I put the ways of childhood behind me. You may be seated. I'd like to use for a topic this morning, more love. More love. Grown-up love. Amen? Let us pray. Eternal and most wise God, I thank you for this hour and these your people and this message that you have given me, O God. Help me right now to bring it to them in a way that is practical and easy to understand, something that we can all apply to our lives when we leave here today. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And so, you know, this week is Valentine's Day, and I know one thing that I was working on with Reb was trying to get enough Valentine's cards for the men at Catawba Correctional Center, because they want to send cards to their mother, to their sister, to their daughter, to their wives. They want to send cards to the people that they love.
And so, girlfriend,
yeah, their girlfriend, and especially their girlfriend, I guess. And so I did put that out in the community, and people have been really good to bring by stacks of Valentine's Day cards so that the men out there at the prison will have one to send someone. And then probably some of us are thinking about, who would I like to give a Valentine's Day card to on Tuesday? Who is it that I want them to know that I love them? People that you love, people that you cherish in your life. A lot of us are working on that. I know I'm looking forward to surprising my husband with flowers on his job on Tuesday. He doesn't know I'm going to do that, but I am. And I want him to be the center of attention when they bring him the flowers. And I want everybody to say, wow, his wife must really love him a lot to send him flowers at work. And I'm going to do special things for him all day long to show him how much I love him. Because that is one of the things that we do on Valentine's, is the people that we love, we want to make sure that they know, and we remind them how special they are to us. Amen?
Amen.
So if you haven't gotten your Valentine's Day cards yet, it's not too late. Not too late for the candy, not too late for the gifts, whatever it is you want to do for the people that you love on Valentine's Day. You still have 2 days left to get it done. But as I was praying about it, and I was asking God, well, everybody knows that. You know, everybody knows that that's what Valentine's Day is for. Most people wouldn't disagree that for the people that you love, you want to do something special for them. No wonder the men at the camp want cards. They can't see everybody they love, but they want to send them a card. That's something that's easy to understand. There's not a whole lot of growth there talking about love on Valentine's Day for the ones that we love. But then God, in my meditation, flipped the script. He said, what if Valentine's Day was for the ones that you don't love? What if Valentine's Day was for you to work on your love, grow up in Christ, and begin to be able to show more love to the ones that get on your last nerve? Amen? There's some people that are just not your favorite person. That is just not my favorite person. If I see them calling on the phone, not going to answer that. Don't want to talk to them. If you see them coming, you might go in the opposite direction because it just annoys me. Or this person let me down. They didn't keep their promise. They didn't do what they said they were going to do. They have disappointed me. I just don't like their personality. I can't even tell you why. I just don't like them. Have you ever had that? People tell you, I don't know why I don't like them. I just don't. Maybe because they remind me of somebody I knew from my past. Maybe something about the way that they act just grates on my nerves. There are just some people that we naturally are repelled by, and we don't love them for whatever reason. We don't feel a whole lot of love for them, and naturally we wouldn't be thinking about giving them a Valentine's Day card.
Not at all.
But that's what God gave me when he flipped the script. He said, what if Valentine's Day was for all of us who call on the name of Jesus and call ourselves Christians, that on that day especially, we try to love the unlovable ones in our lives. Hey, y'all with me?
Yeah.
The unlovable ones. We all got a list. There might be some unlovable ones on that list. What if Tuesday, God was asking you to reach out to that person or to those people and to try to have more love, to try to grow up in Christ and to love them like God has loved you. Amen? God has loved us in our mess. God has loved us right where we are. And so we are to be his ambassadors and shed his love abroad in our hearts to other people. And maybe on Valentine's Day, we can just do a reverse Valentine's Day this year and think about the unlovable ones and what can we do to love them. Y'all with me? Amen? You might be going, I don't want to hear that. That's not something I want to hear. But this whole passage about love, this is about the highest form of love, agape love. When Paul is talking about love in this chapter, he's talking about the kind of love that comes from God. This is the kind of love that we experience from God. And this is the kind of love that God would have us to share in the world. C.S. Lewis, in his book, The Four Loves, he talks about agape love, and he says that he described the word, he used the word agape to describe what he believed was the highest level of love known to humanity. A selfless love. A love that was passionately committed to the well-being of the other. Agape love involves faithfulness, commitment, and an act of the will. Agape love, or the kind of love that comes from God. I'm not talking about man's love. Man's love is very conditional. I'll love you if. I'll love you when. But God's love loves at all times, just where we are. There's nothing that we can do to separate us from the love of God. That kind of love, agape love is an action. It is shown by what it does. Agape love is hard to talk about. Agape love is what you live. Agape love is spiritual. It's mature. It's grown-up love. And in John 13, 34 and 35, Jesus said this, a new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. Not love your neighbor as you love yourself. This is different. This is a higher kind of love. As Jesus said, as I have loved you, you are to love one another in that same way. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another as I have loved you. Now, that's something for y'all to think about. As I have loved you, that's what Jesus is saying. That is how you are to love one another. And when you do that, the world will know that you are my disciples. And so on Valentine's Day, I just ask you to look at the quality of your love. Look at the quality of the love that you share in your life with other people. The quality of your love that people would look at you and say, I see God in him or I don't. Is our Christian love maturing for people who are hard to love and unlovable? Back to that scripture where it says, when I was a child, I talked like a child, I thought like a child, I reasoned like a child, but when I became a man or a woman, I put the childish things behind me. And one of the greatest examples of this kind of love is Mother Lynch, the mother of our church. She is 86 years old. She has seen a lot in her life, and her theology and the things that she feels are right and wrong, and what she's gone through. She might disagree with you. She might not even like what you're doing, but she said, I learned that it's my job to love and God's job to judge. Amen? So she's had to accept a lot of things at 86 years old about the way the world works, that she doesn't understand, that she doesn't like. As an 86-year-old person, she doesn't approve of a lot of what goes on. But she said, it's my job to love and God's job to judge. And so she decided that she would begin to love like God loves. She would begin to love the ones who would really otherwise wouldn't be lovable to her. But she said, that's my job is to love. That's especially my job is to love the most unlovable ones, the ones I disagree with the most, the ones I disapprove of the most. That's my job to love them even more. Amen? Ask her about it sometime. She'll tell you when she had her spiritual awakening on that one. It's my job to love and God's job to judge. This kind of love doesn't come naturally to us, my brothers and sisters. This is not the way that man loves. Agape love comes from God to us by the Holy Spirit. And in Romans 5, verses 5 through 8, it says, and hope does not put us to shame because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. And so we need the Holy Spirit to help us to love like that. I do. In my own, you know, natural love, it's conditional. It comes and goes. But when I'm tapped into God's love, when I'm tapped into the Holy Spirit moving in my heart and in my spirit, it compels me to love past that. It compels me to love the unlovable. And you know, I couldn't have been here 20 years if I hadn't been able to love the unlovable. Amen? Let me get that knife out of my back. Well, I tell you that I love you on the way out the door. Want to see you in church. Even if you leave wrong, I still want to see you in church. I don't want to see anything bad happen to you. I've learned to love because God has shown me how much He loves me in my mess. Who am I not to love you in your mess? Amen? And so we need to ask God to help us to love like He loves. And so I'm putting that to you right now. For Valentine's Day, if you think about those on your list of the unlovable, not my favorite person, not somebody I would normally even try to love or show love to on Valentine's Day, that's who God is asking you to think about right now, this week. How can you have more love for them? How can you have more love for them? How can you get more love from God so you can have more love for them? So that in loving them, the world will know that you are His disciples. And you might say, well, you know, I love people who love me. I love, you know, that's the way I do. If they love me, I'll love them back. If they don't love me, I'm not going to love them back. Why should I? But Jesus says in Luke 6 and 32, if you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. So Jesus was saying, trading love with other people is not what we're talking about in terms of grown-up love, the highest form of love, agape love. I love you if you love me. No, Jesus said, if that's all you're willing to do, you're no better than the sinners who don't love anybody. What credit is that to you? He's saying God doesn't give you a lot of credit for loving people who love you already. God gives you a lot of credit and blesses you spiritually for loving people who don't. And I'm telling you, there have been people in this ministry, I have learned how to love people who did not love me. I know everybody doesn't love me. I know. I got some haters out there. Amen? Yeah, Antonio, I do. I got some haters out there. I've had some Miss Susan haters over the years. Probably not as many today as I had back in the beginning when people didn't trust me. What's she doing here? What does she really want? Why is she up in there with Greg? What is that all about? I have really had some haters over the years, and I had to learn how to absorb their mistrust or their, you know, ever how they perceive me. And I wasn't, hey, listen, I'm embarrassed about the way I acted when I first got here. I don't know about you, James, 5 years ago, but when you got here, you're not the man you are today. And I certainly was not the woman I am today 20 years ago. Back 20 years ago, I could even understand why some people would be a Susan hater. Because my behavior, I just wasn't there yet. I hadn't grown up enough in Christ. And so, but I had to learn how to deal with that and to love those who didn't love me. Because I thought to myself, Jesus said, if you only love the ones that love you, what is that? That's not doing a lot spiritually. You have to learn to love the ones who don't love you. The ones that you're not their favorite person, and maybe they let you know that you need to love them more. Ouch. Happy Valentine's Day. Think about it. You got some haters out there. Valentine's Day is the day you can show them that you love them more because God has loved you, and that's the kind of love that you are to share so the world will know that you are His disciples. And so if you say, well, how can I grow up? I want to grow up in Christ. I want to have more love. I want to be a more mature spiritual person. I want my love to count with God. I hear what Jesus is saying. Trading love with people who love me is really not that hard. There's no growth in that. Loving people who don't love me or loving people who are unlovable, that's where the spiritual growth comes in. And so if you want to grow up, if you want to have more love, then this is what you need to do. Are y'all ready? Say, I'm ready.
I'm ready.
Number one, be patient. Say, love is patient.
It is.
We have to be able to remain calm and wait on God to work things out in our lives and in the lives of other people. Y'all say, stay calm.
Stay calm.
And just take a deep breath. Just stay calm. Don't get upset. Don't be irritable, restless, and discontent. Stay calm. Let the Spirit calm you down and help you to wait on God with this other person or with these other people. God is doing something in their lives too, just like He's doing something in yours. And so when we're patient with other people, trusting and believing that they're His children too, that God is working on them also, that we're none of us on the same timeline, we've got to be patient with people. Remain calm and wait on God to work things out in their lives and in the lives of others. It's hard to wait. It's hard to wait, but it's not that hard to wait on God. Not for me. If I'm waiting on the bus, if I'm waiting on my food, if I'm waiting on something like that, that's a little bit harder. But if I'm waiting on God, I know that it takes God time sometimes to work on folks. It took God time to work on me. And I'm not done yet. I am not by a long shot done. God is still growing me up as a woman of God. And when I look in the mirror and I say, am I ever going to be there? Am I ever going to get it? You know, we'll be working on it as long as we're walking the earth. We're going to be working on ourselves. And so be patient with people. Just be calm and let God do what He's doing with them and with us. Don't get upset. Number two, be kind. It says love is kind. That means having or showing a gentle nature and a desire to help others. And I know that one of my favorite things about Reverend Holland when he prays at the end of the service, and by the way, he's back home again. He's doing a lot better. He says, oh God, he's talking about the ones that are out there doing wrong, not right, in the wrong place at the wrong time with the wrong people doing the wrong thing for the wrong reasons. When he's praying for them, wanting more love, he says, God, touch him with a finger of love, not a finger of wrath. Turn them around right easy. I love that. I love that analogy that God is kind. He has a gentle nature and compassionate towards us that when we're in our mess, then He touches us with a finger of love and turns us around right easy. Not a finger of condemnation, not a finger of wrath, but a finger of love to turn us around right easy. And so it is with us. Can we be kind? Can we be loving towards those who are not there yet, who are getting on our nerves, the unlovable ones in our life? Can we pray that God would touch them? Pray for them. Sometimes we can't help folk. Amen? Because sometimes there are people we really can't help them. But we can pray for them. And Jesus said, pray for them. Pray for them that God would touch them with a finger of love and turn them around right easy. Don't pray that God's going to strike them down. Don't pray for their demise. Pray for their salvation. Pray that God is going to help them. And only you and God know what you pray about in your heart. Mm-hmm. Are you sincerely praying for the ones that are unlovable, the ones that have wronged you, the ones that you don't really feel? I'm not feeling them. Can you be kind towards them? And even if you can't do anything for them, can you pray that God will touch them with a finger of love and turn them around right easy? It's a good prayer. It's something that'll keep you, it won't hurt you when you pray that. When you pray anger and wrath and condemnation and destruction for another person, it hurts you too. Amen? That's not a good prayer. But when you pray love for another person, God touch them with a finger of love, help them and turn them around right easy. Get them on the right path. That's something that's good for you too. When you pray that prayer, you have gotten more of God's love in that prayer, because God realizes you're loving somebody that hasn't loved you. You're doing something that God gives you credit for. Number three, if you want to have more love, if you want to flip the script on Valentine's Day and try to love somebody that you haven't been able to love for a long time, don't feel like it, says love is not envy. When we are loving in this way, when we have agape love, we're happy to see other people get a blessing that we would like for ourselves. Maybe it's something we want, but it's hard for us to be happy for somebody when they get it. And we envy. And sometimes we have negative feelings for them. How come they got that? That's what I want. I should have got that, not them. Love does not envy. Love is always happy to see people blessed, especially in the ways that we would like to be blessed. Be glad and thank God for their blessings, and just say, God, I know that you will bless me too, and I'm willing to wait on the blessing that's coming my way. It might not be exactly what you did for them, but when you really love people, you don't envy what God is doing for them. You don't have a jealous spirit towards them, like, well, you know, I can't be happy for you because that hadn't happened for me yet. Love in this way, when you see people rising up and succeeding, be glad for them, be happy for them, and build them up. It also says love doesn't boast and is not proud. That just means that you're humble. That when you love, that you're not always trying to be a me first kind of person. Me up front, me in the center, it's always about me. It's not always about me. Agape love is a we thing, not a me thing. Amen? Yes. This kind of love is a we thing, not a me thing. And I know a lot of times in Narcotics Anonymous, our sponsor will give us the basic text and say, go through there and encircle every one of the we's in the book. Because the point is, this is a we program, not a me program. We do it together. We don't do it alone. And so agape love, this kind of love, more love, when we start to think in a we mentality and not a me mentality, God is able to bless that and help us to and give more love in the way that he loves, and then see what God does for that. In Philippians 2, verses 3 and 4, it says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. That's a we thing. Y'all, that's a we thing. So for Valentine's Day, think about, how can I be more of a we person? Are there areas of life where I'm being a me person? Where I'm being a me first person? Where I got to be an upfront person? Where I need to have my name called? I've got to be in the spotlight. It's got to be about what I want and how I want it. Can I be more of a we person? Are there people that I've hurt by my me attitude? And do I need to be more humble and remember that their interests are just as important as mine? For Valentine's Day, flip the script. What do you need to work on? Where do you need to work on that? It says love is not easily angered. That means that we're not cranky, temperamental, quarrelsome, irritable, that we're calm, that we're even-tempered, and we're laid back. And I thought about this, if we're not easily angered, and this is something that's helped me a lot, because I used to have a pretty quick temper. When I think about it, how hot-headed I used to be. And I'm just not that way anymore. I really am not. And the reason is because I have the balancing pole of Christ with me at all times. You know, like the tightrope walker who's walking across the tightrope and he's trying to keep his balance. He's got that pole. And if he starts to get off balance this way, he pulls the pole that way. And as he walks and he starts to get off balance this way, he pulls the pole that way. That is how Christ works for me. I've got the balancing pole of Christ in my hand, so as I go through life and something starts to set me off and I feel like snapping, blanking on somebody, you know? You feel like you're going to blank and you're going this way, take the pole of Christ and get yourself right back again. You know, get ready to snap. I'm getting ready to tell them off. Christ will help you get your balance and keep you to not be one who is easily angered. Can I get an amen on that?
Amen.
All of us probably need to work on that, to have more love. Take the balancing pole of Christ with you in everything you think about, talk about, and do, and it will help you to remain calm. And when you start to get out of focus and start to blank, it'll pull you back into the blessed place in Christ, to where you remember that it's not all about me. It's a we thing. God's working with them too. And in order for me to show them more love right now, I just need to be still and let God be God. It says love keeps no records of wrongs. Love is forgiving. Amen? We don't have a tab where we keep track of every wrong thing that somebody did. We do. But you know, if we realize that other people can keep tabs on us too for every wrong thing that we ever did, please forgive me. If we want to be forgiven, then we need to forgive also. Just when people ask to be forgiven, when they're repenting, when they're trying again, we forgive them. We don't hold grudges. More love is not holding grudges. Amen? And some of us have some acts that we like to grind, we've been dragging around with us for 20, 30 years. That's the person we really don't want to send them a Valentine's Day card. But it's over and done. They've said they're sorry. There's nothing we can do about it now. Why not just forgive them and move on? Send them a Valentine's Day card today. Someone who asked for your forgiveness and you still haven't let them know that you forgive them. Send them a Valentine's Day card and say, I love you in the name of Jesus and I forgive you. Don't hold grudges. And the last two I really like, it says love does not delight in evil. It means that we don't get our kicks out of malicious enjoyment of the mishaps or misfortunes of other people. We're not happy when someone gets what they deserved. You know, and sometimes we are. Sometimes that's gossip right there. When we talk about people and, Lord, you hear what happened to him? Well, he had it coming. You know, and you get into it. It's like it's exciting. It's the drama and chaos that we get addicted to in life. And when we learn to have the kind of love that God has for us, for other people, I don't care what happens to that person, how much they might have brought it on themselves, I'm not going to rejoice in it. Amen? I'm not going to be happy that you got what was coming to you. I don't think like that. God, that's not the kind of love that God has for me. And that's not the kind of love that God wants us to have for other people. It's hard to delight in the misfortunes of those you love, no matter what they have done. And so when people leave the program wrong, and then later we get a phone call, you believe he's back in jail? You believe he went back to prison? She had a car wreck? I get no pleasure out of saying, well, that's what they get because they left too soon. They didn't learn. They didn't recover. They didn't have a program. I get no joy out of that, and we shouldn't either. We shouldn't be glad for the misfortunes of other people no matter what they did to bring it on themselves. We should always pray. That's agape love. God, I pray that you're with them right now. You know all about it. You know what happened. You know how they got there. Help them right now in the name of Jesus. So we don't love, does not delight in evil. As a matter of fact, we don't even participate in that kind of gossip. I'm just throwing that out there. We start to gossip about people and all what's going on with them because they didn't do right. It's almost like we're enjoying it. It's our entertainment. That's not agape love. Agape love says, I'm sorry to hear that. Yes. You know, and I hope that they get the help that they need. I hope they have a spiritual awakening. I hope they have a turnaround now. But we don't delight in evil. And the last one says that love rejoices in the truth. Love rejoices with the whole truth, not partial truth. Love knows the difference between a momentary mistake and a persistent pattern of immoral behavior. Love does not blind us to the lifetime achievements of a person because of the fact of a single error or errors. Love has the perspective to see the whole truth and does not obsess on one sin as though it negated the rest of life. Love rejoices with the truth, the reality of redemption, that Christ has come to forgive us and give us a new start when we repent and turn to Him in faith. And this is the point. Love rejoices with the truth that failure is not final. Amen? Failure is not final. That's the truth. And so when we love people who just seem to be getting into the same trap over and over again, not learning the lessons that life has been trying to teach them time after time, love rejoices with the truth that failure is not final. Amen? You don't give up on people. If anybody had given up on Reggie Longcrier back in the day, how many times has he been in prison? How many times has he relapsed? love, but the people who continue to believe in him, like his mother continued to believe in him no matter how many times he fell down, how many times he went to prison. A mother's love is as close to God's love as it gets, because we're going to love our child regardless of what it is that's going on in their life, because we believe in who they are becoming and not who they are right now. Amen? What they can become and not what they are necessarily at that moment. And so that's the message this morning, my brothers and sisters, about more love for Valentine's Day. Flip the script and think about, where do I need to be more loving? And if you want to be more loving to the ones that you don't love very much, the ones you don't like, the ones that are, you're not feeling them, that's the very place you need to work on it. Amen? That's exactly where you need to work on it, is with those people. Those people are your Jesus test. Those people are the ones that will help you grow spiritually more than anybody that loves you and you love them back. Amen? So more love for Valentine's Day. And the way that you do that is say, God, show me how much you love me. Pour your Holy Spirit into me and help me to see how much you love me, how patient you are with me, how kind you've been to me, how it is that you're happy for me, you want to bless me, how it is that you're long-suffering, oh God, that you'll always give me another chance, not just a second chance. What if we only got a second chance from God? God always gave us another chance, has he not? You think about those things, how God has given you another chance time and time again. That God was never up in heaven or in the spiritual realm saying, well, he got what he deserved, or she got what was coming to her. God's heart is always compassionate, always has a sympathetic consciousness towards our distress and has a desire to help us relieve that stress. God is compassionate towards us. God loves us in that way. God knows that any failure that we experience is not final. God loves us like that. And I pray that if you don't know that love yet, that you will. And all you have to do is say, I'm ready to know you, oh God. Please stand. That is the message this morning. I'm ready.